whatever. The whole thing could have been consensual. That's not the point. My point is, O'Reilly, whatever, should have not had one conversation with her. I don't know, what would be the reason to go to dinner?
And certainly not a conversation.
Why don't you take Courtney to dinner and discuss the show tonight, and then let me know how Carol likes it.
No, I would never do that.
Okay, well, then,
nor have I ever.
There you go. I rest my case.
Well, anything even resembling
that
type of behavior, like Sid taking the girls up to the Hustler Club.
I understand that.
I don't go that way.
No. I know that.
You've
my
never
point.
Advised a woman to buy a vibrator and
well, that's like a crazy. No.
And name it. That's my point.
But that's an allegation that's unsubstantiated at this time.
Precisely.
By perhaps a gold-digging hoe.
It very well. I mean, we don't know. We don't know how to characterize it. We don't know.
Here's the thing that it doesn't sound. It doesn't sound good, regardless.
Well,
this is the last thing you want to open the papers and find Fox in the XXX factor. That's not what you're wanting to find. And there's your picture with this,
And it goes on the Today Show with a lawyer.
It's not
talking to Lester Holt.
That's what you don't want.
No.
You don't want, like, remember Marv Albert, you don't want Marv tied to Dead Dominatrix.
No.
The headline in the Post, I mean, you don't want that, because they found Marv's name in her address book.
Just not looking good for the factor.
I mean, you just don't, whatever.
And the subhead here in the Daily News, all the shocking details on pages 22 and 23. No.
That's what you don't want.
Let me flip to 22 and 23.
The opening bell of the New York Stock Exchange is sponsored probably, let me see, by your tri-state Jeep dealer, trail-rated capability only in a Jeep 4x4. Crude oil is selling at $53.66. The Dow has slipped below 10,000, Charles.
Huh.
The NASDAQ is down 70 cents. The Dow is down almost $11 at 9991.
Yeah.
So, it's great economic recovery out of this recession with your guy, and that's where we are. What do you have now, Chuck?
What do you mean?
Well, you said you're going to turn to page 22 or 23.
Oh, well, yeah, I do.
Well, what do you have?
According to Macris, this has been going on a couple of years.
And who would Macris be?
That's the woman,
okay.
Andrea Macris, who is an associate producer of The O'Reilly Factor.
Who wrote an email a few days ago talking about how happy she was at Fox.
What a wonderful experience it was, and that she felt that she's home and she will never leave again. She went to CNN for a while and then came back.
Sure.
According to Macris, start 2 years of lewdness, during which O'Reilly regaled her with tales of threesomes with Swedish stewardesses, graphically described Thai sex shows, forced her to sit through stories about his amazing, quote, amazing penis, penis size, his physical endowment, and how he himself, O'Reilly, lost his virginity. About a Caribbean sex fantasy involving her, a hot shower and a little loofah thing, you know, a loofah sponge, she says.
A what?
Loofah sponge, you know, it's a scrub sponge. You use.
Come on, everybody knows what a loofah is.
The steamy detail and direct quotes appear in court papers suggest Macris was either taking notes or had a tape recorder running as O'Reilly allegedly was talking in this manner. So, I don't know. O'Reilly boasted about bringing a woman, quote, to her first orgasm as he spoke to her on the phone, then allegedly said to Ms. Macris,
"Let me tell you the same stories." I don't know.
So, who knows?
She took a job back with O'Reilly. She went into his hotel room to watch a Bush press conference. She went to dinner with him again, according to her.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, how fearful was she?
Right. How shocked and... Exactly. I don't know.
Because at that point, she had decided to set him up.
Yes, but he shouldn't have put himself in a position to be set up. To be set up. There's nobody to...
No question.
Bill has nobody to blame here. She may be everything you say she is, but she wouldn't be in that position had he not acquiesced. That's my point.
No, nobody's perfect.
Oh, God almighty. Gotta do it.
Yeah. CBS, Night of Television, CBS, CSI is TV.
NBC. I just...
You can't even go. Can't even talk about it. You
can't even talk about it, so... Well, Sid thinks the solution is that you get into one of these situations for Mr. O'Reilly, if he'd just been thinking what the solution. If he just followed the Gary Condit model.
Oh, my God.
We could have taken guesses at what the solution is.
Find a body parts in a park.
Right.
It's all over.
Sure.
Your word against mine now. Well, now what are you going to say?
It didn't work. Gary Condit's still alive, isn't he?
Oh, he's not. He got off.
Okay, never mind.
So, I mean... Well, the only thing, having sat here and watched the parade go by for 30 years...
What?
Charles will attest to this as well. Is we've seen these various stories emerge, and it's quickly determined if there's something there or not. And if there is something there, it is over. So
this is...
I don't mean...
No, I understand. This would go far beyond, you know, Marv, the problems that Mr. Albert had or anything.
No, this is worse than that. The only thing worse than this is McGreevy. That's the only thing worse. No, this is still a woman. You can't get caught blowing the...
Hey, wait a minute. No.
Stop it.
They can't put the guy in charge of security for the state of New Jersey because he's, you know, shacking up with you.
He's
heading in the rear door of the mansion over there in Trenton.
I think you put him in charge of Homeland Security 5 minutes after September 11th.
Oh, my God.
Jimmy, who's your daddy?
Well, how many people from New Jersey got, God bless them, were actually killed in the World Trade Center? And you put your boyfriend?
Some 700 or whatever it was? My God.
And you put your boyfriend in charge of Homeland Security? I mean... McGreevy should be in prison.
Be in Guantanamo.
Oh, he's a horrid human being. And probably a crook.
A piece of garbage to boot.
Really, he really is. That's a...
Low life.
Yeah. That's a real low life. I mean, that's stunty pull, but putting this guy in...
My boy toy.
I mean, if you want to have his boy toy, then make him whatever. Well, I mean, once you've made that decision, but put him in charge of Homeland Security, I mean, that's... I've often wondered here why people weren't more outraged by it, huh? So, well, whatever.
He's still in office.
Well, no, I understand that.
He refuses to go.
There's Tom from New York City on line one. Good morning, Tom.
Tom from New York City.
On line one. Good morning, Tom. How you doing, baby?
All right.
What's Lou left the studio? That's a great idea. Lou, I'm here talking on the radio, and Lou leaves the studio. He's a crazy man.
He's sick of hearing you.
Good morning, Tom.
Good morning, hi, man. How are you?
All right, baby.
Good God, man. What were you thinking? That was you on Time Magazine?
Yeah.
Oh, my God. Listen, the warden down at Camp Cupcake, he's been having problems with the inmates. So he's threatening conjugal visits by you if they don't straighten out. And let me tell you something. They're scared straight you coming down there on a Saturday.
I don't need you to call up and make me feel bad. Get off my phone, you horrible person. 13 till the hour. That's not helpful.
That's not nice. How's that nice?
That's ugly.
Well, it reminds me, when you posted these photographs with photographers, I remember one time, the worst ever happened to me is that skunk Harry Benson got me to pose in. Remember that pool picture in Southport?
Oh, where you looked like a limp linguine floating in a...
And the same way, same thing with this photographer from Time, he said, well, I like it when you're, I'm just fixing my hat, you know. So it looks good when you're adjusting your hat. Well, of course, it doesn't look good. It looks hideous. But when you agree to do these things, well, that's what happens. So ordinarily, but because I agree to so few of these, ordinarily I say to the photographer, you can shoot, depending if they're shooting with a, say, a 2.25 format, usually they have 12 shots in the magazine. So you can take 12 photographs. Or if they're shooting with a, that nobody shoots with a, for these kinds of things with a 35 millimeter, but in that case, and you can take a few more, but a 36 or whatever the roll is. But I was trying to be accommodating, and it was just a huge...
Your usual good guy.
Yeah. It was a mistake, so, but it's fine.
Benevolent individual?
Just got to move on, and it's no big deal.
It is a huge deal.
Well, tonight, the Cardinals will take on Houston again. Who pitches for Houston tonight?
So tonight is going to be
Pete Monroe.
Pete Monroe, right. Oswald.
Clemens
3, Oswald 4, yeah.
Who pitches for the Cardinals tonight, Charles?
Matt Morris.
And how's Matt?
He's good.
Exactly. I'm talking to Charles.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm out of it.
He's had some problems with consistency of late. But his last outing, he looked really good.
What are the chances of seeing Rick and Keel during this series?
Zero.
Why?
Well, just because. It's not going to happen.
Never.
But he's not on the playoff roster.
No, that's the first thing.
Right. So it's zero.
About as good as seeing you pitch for the Cardinals this series. Watch Tim McCarver catch.
Which would be pretty much the same result.
Pretty much, yeah.
Although Mr. Ankiel apparently has gotten it back together, right, or something?
We're hoping that he has.
No, he hasn't.
What do you mean?
Well, if he's about together, he'd be on a playoff team. He's not about together. He's a mess still.
Well, he won a game.
They don't want to throw him into that kind of situation.
Oh, stop it. Yeah. Stop it. The guy is a mess. His father's in federal prison.
No. What has it got to do? That's like disparaging your parents because of you.
What you've done before, by the way.
No. You have two nice parents. You're a scum bunny.
You have to be mortified.
I don't know if that's true. I think that's an overstatement on your part.
No, it's not. It's an accurate one.
Are you surprised that Paris Hilton is not only a slut but a racist? Are you surprised about that? Paris Hilton throws the N-word around all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Another story in today's Russian Malloy. Hey, Bernie, what did you say in that video? The last video?
She called them dumb niggas, except with E-R at the end instead of A-S.
Right. But now she's in trouble again.
What now?
Well, I guess she
called two fashion designers dumb niggas.
Yeah.
Again, with the ER, but apparently her boyfriend, ex-boyfriend, says she throws the N-word around all the time.
Yeah.
More times than she, you know,
why
a leg down.
Here's my question.
What? What's that?
Why does this woman get any sort of notoriety? Why are you two even discussing her?
She's a huge deal.
She's a star, I mean.
How is she a star?
She is a star by being a star.
Yeah.
She has achieved her celebrity by being a celebrity.
She's a beautiful, filthy, rich slut.
Right.
Therefore, she's
a star. And there's a third porn.
There's a third, yes.
Well, that's... Yeah.
Well, that's what she says, the N-word, and supposedly she's doing blow with a bunch of guys and having sex. She's doing two-on-ones and lesbian sex. And you ask me why we're talking about it, why she's a star?
Described as the most explicit one yet.
Yeah.
That's the third one, right. The second one is the one with the N-word.
She's a true American is what she is. She's a treasure.
I love her.
She's an American treasure.
So this is becoming a situation where when I leave the studio, you got to go take a shower.
Yeah.
This is just...
I just wish there was a tape of Bill O'Reilly talking dirty to Paris Hilton.
Oh, well, I'm sure there is. Well, not Paris Hilton, but I'm sure there's a tape here. And if Rob or Larry can do him
one. Well, I just opened Sirius phone service.
How's that vibrator of the factor? Interested. Let's go.
Well, it looks like Barry Manilow's admitting he's gay.
Wait, let me get up off the floor.
Oh, you're kidding. Hold on now. Wait a minute.
Barry Manilow going to talk to
the singer, Barry Manilow?
Yeah, shocking headline.
Really? Again, from Joanna Malloy, Madison Square Garden concert last Thursday. When he introduced the duet, he was about to sing with Brian Darcy James, who's in a musical with Barry called Harmony. And Emmanuel told the audience that the two would sing the ballad every single day, but we're not going to sing it to each other because that would be kind of creepy. And he's apologized now to... fags and lesbians for being
shut up.
I miss in the morning.
At Friendly Motor Cars, 134 Old Post Road in Wappinger Falls, and Mercedes-Benz of Danbury, 100 Federal Road in Danbury. There it is.
If you're going to bring your daughter out and try to say, look, I'm not a hard-edged right-wing nut, I have a lesbian daughter. You're going to use her for that purpose.
That doesn't excuse Senator Kerry doing it. That's my point.
Two wrongs sometimes do make a right.
Oh, well, you're just naive and stupid.
I just don't get the sense that the Bush campaign has exploited her in that way this time around, whether or not Cheney brought up the name before in 2000.
Well, Dick Cheney has disagreed with the president publicly over...
But it was just so out of left field during this debate when Bob Schieffer is trying to find out whether the president thinks being a homosexual is either a choice or not. To then use her as an example was gratuitous, and you know it was. I don't care what else happened.
Hers is the only face that they can put on this issue.
How about Barney Frank?
How about
Jim
McGreevy?
Being gay is not equivalent
to being
a
ballpark Frank.
A heroin addict or you know.
Oh, well, you're just...
That's the way you're... That's your thinking.
What's my thinking?
That there's something wrong with being a lesbian.
There's nothing wrong with being a lesbian.
Oh, what you...
You.
Like that she's some sort of freak. Dude. You know, they have a freaky...
Or
a crook.
That is not my point.
He didn't call her a tuna-sucking butch or anything like that. He was polite about it.
Oh, Jesus, you just... You are the biggest pig. Now, this is not an example, boys and girls, where I'm professing
you
indignance...
You are a phony!
And then encouraging Bernard to continue this line of rhetoric. I'm not. Please shut up.
Where's the outrage over the kids that Cheney sent off to die for a reason that wasn't true? For a hidden agenda. Come on.
Absolutely.
Let's focus on that.
Okay,
forget about the lesbian.
Oh, right. I agree.
That's legitimate.
Anyway, 10 minutes after the hour.
Latest polling, I imagine.
All right.
Very quickly. New Zogby poll, just out, shows President Bush, as you suggested earlier this morning in a conversation off the air, that President Bush has opened a 4-point lead over Senator Kerry. That follows an ABC News poll, though, also just out, that shows the incumbent and Mr. Kerry tied 48% each, although it is also suggested that it, if you look at them over time, it means that the president has lost a number of points. Well, Senator Kerry has gained a number of points. The fact that they would be...
God, you sound like Kerry trying to answer a question.
Well, you've got to look at
what has happened
since these debates began. The president has lost and Senator Kerry has gained. That simple.
Let me just echo the sentiments of Rudolph Giuliani. The president will win this election. I'm going to vote for Senator Kerry, period. In fact, I'll do it on camera, on MSNBC, Election Day morning, over on the west side of Manhattan.
Make your point.
President Bush will win this election by 4 or 5 points, period.
Which is what this
case was.
Zogby poll suggests.
You're going to hurt yourself on that fence.
I'm not on any fence.
What do you mean? You're about to...
I'm telling you what's going to happen.
You're impaled on a fence.
I know. You know what I'd like to impale you on? I'm sure you'd like it as well. Coming up on 12 minutes
Wait a minute,
after the hour.
That's a low blow.
Let's pursue that. What are you talking about? And by the way, if you're Bill O'Reilly, it doesn't make any difference whether this was a consensual situation, whether in fact she's a dirtbag jacking up poor old Bill and my friend Roger Hills for 60 mil or whatever. If she has any tape of him making the kinds of comments that she says he made in her complaint, which read like a transcript of a telephone conversation,
it is
over.
You know, the more I watch this girl on television,
yeah,
and she's on there right now, by the way, she shouldn't have sued Bill O'Reilly. She should have sent him a Rolex. Who also pay attention to this effing hippopotamus?
No. That's not the...
That's the shock of the whole thing.
Yeah.
It's that he's going to ruin his life and his career over some beast.
Oh, my God. She should love the guy. She should love him.
Somebody he took under his wing.
Yeah.
And helped her out. Gave her a raise. Gave her some advice. He was her mentor.
She should send
He was looking
him
out for her.
Yeah, she should send him a new watch. What are you suing the guy for?
What happened to his watch?
Oh, God.
I never understand these women. I don't get it. They come to work and they get all dolled up and they're begging you to say something nice about him, and then you do.
No,
and they
can't.
Try to cut your
you can't be making phone calls
describing your penis size.
No,
come on. You can't call somebody on the phone who works for
allegedly
you when you're married, or even if you're not married, talking about your Donkey Kong. You just can't do it.
Even O'Reilly's human.
Yeah, I mean, you can't
then purport to be and pontificate about being the moral authority of the country and wail on poor old Ludacris and R. Kelly and my homeboys and then be married with two kids out on Long Island and make filthy phone calls to the help.
Allegedly. It doesn't look good, but...
It doesn't make any... No, it doesn't. By the way, if there's any tape, he's a dead man. It doesn't make any difference whether I'm sure I would suspect she probably was a willing participant.
Of course,
I suspect she probably did try to jack him up for $60 million. By the way, Bill doesn't have $60 million. But my point is that if he just said the words on the telephone and it's on tape, he's over.
Well, it wasn't over for Bill Clinton, and he raped a woman, and then wiggled his peedy at another one, and then had another one in the Oval Office.
He allegedly
it worked just fine.
Woman.
He's a popularity. He's an all-time
high. Didn't have the liberal media to wail on him. And incidentally, Bernard made a great point. I called Rick Kaplan yesterday. I said, get the debate off of my television and get this O'Reilly stuff on there, Tubbo. And he's screaming, laughing. He's not going to take my advice, thank God. But all anybody wants to watch, particularly is cable TV. The Nightly News did 2.5 minutes on it last night. MSNBC's been wailing on it. Abrams did 30 minutes on it. Scarborough did 30 minutes. Fox can't report it.
Fox is doing Scott Peterson.
So they're getting screwed twice here. Poor old Bill's taking them down, and they can't report it, which is what everybody wants to see. The no-spin zone, yeah, the no... We report, you decide. Well, how about reporting this one, Fox?
And we'll decide.
Party! We report, you decide.
Eat me.
Part of your morning is back. Bob Edwards, the award-winning journalist from Public
Electoral Commission of Iraq.
I am Army Major General Ibrahim Abu Mohammed, and I am approving this message.
There is new day dawning in Iraq, and soon will be democratic elections. And when they come to pass, there is only one choice you may make. Ibrahim Abu Mohammed. His record as former Ba'ath Party member is without mark. His opponent, Mahmoud El-Kharzar, despite his position in Hamas, has not been definitive leader, failing to assassinate infidels who side with the great Satan. El-Kharzar is flip-flopper, pledging to torture detainees, cut off their hands, turn deaf ears to their lamentations and screams for mercy, and yet, when faced with carrying through on his promise, neglected to perform this holy fatwa. Abu Muhammad is only former Ba'ath Party member, endorsed by the Islamic Jihad leadership and the Camel Jockeys Union. El-Khazar is supported only by special interest groups, such as the Sunni Muslims and Mothers Against Burqa Wearing. Abu Muhammad has been strongly in favor of jihad tax credits for explosive devices. El-Khazar has not. Abu Muhammad has voted consistently for the No Goat Left Behind program. El-Khazar has not. El-Khazar was member of committee to reform Madrasa's terrorist Head Start program, and yet when measure was brought before Islamic Council, did not show up for vote. Is this the type of cowardly infidel pig dog you want in office? This January, vote Ibrahim Abu Mohammed. Iraq. Respected at home, see you.
No. 23 minutes after the hour here in the Average Morning Program. I got a very funny... Well, I think it's funny. Now, I'm not going to give you the guy's name because he probably means well. And I just don't want to... There's no point in embarrassing somebody. But this is sleazy. Well, some movie creep out in Malibu, California, sends me a letter.
Yeah.
Books and some. He's got a couple of books that he's doing. These are historical novels, he describes them. And they're going to make movies of them. Well, that's all fine. So he wants to make a contribution to the Imus Ranch for Kids with Cancer.
Mm-hmm.
He said, I'd be pleased to have it formalized with whatever entity you designate. I'd like to offer a 1% share in the net from all revenues associated with...
Here we go.
So this is some guy, some sleazebag, who's going to try to give me a net deal? What do you think? I was born tonight, but I wasn't born last night. Get out of my face. What are you, nuts? You're going to give me a net deal? So I promote their project. Oh, my God almighty, are you nuts?
I'll take it.
Hey.
Spencer.
A net deal.
I mean, I just laughed out loud.
What's the matter, Charles?
Well, Charles is shaking his head.
Well, I mean, the whole thing that you've said for 10,000 years. Write the check. Get out of my face.
If you want to contribute money to the Imus Cattle Ranch for Kids with Cancer, write me a check. Don't get me to try to promote your sleazy, cheesy, low-rent, not-gonna-happen jive product or movie deal.
For every hamburger we sell,
by offering me a 1% of your a net deal, which is a joke, and it's been a joke in Hollywood forever. There's never any net. There wasn't a net on Lord of the Rings, for God's sake. Although Michael Lynn and Bob Shea would be more than likely, well, I know Mike Lynn would pay you as opposed to some of these other people who won't pay you. You're not getting a net deal. It's laughable.
It's offensive.
Jeez.
Get out.
So how long before Julian Barbieri, by the way, steps up with a class action suit against Terry Bradshaw? That's my question. Now that this girl opened the door with Bill O'Reilly, Barbieri's got to be next.
Hey, Bo.
Bo. Oh. Yeah, I'm here.
Well, I said, hey, Bo.
Hey, Don, American detective on the case again. I was talking to Big Bill yesterday. Got big meetings today.
Talking to Bill who?
Bill O'Reilly.
Let me explain something to you, Bo.
Yes, sir.
If there's any tape, it's over.
Can I just say something?
Sure.
4 years ago, I got hired by one of the top real estate guys. It was a $200 million sexual harassment case. Some woman that was working in the office, she worked there, she came back. $200 million. This chump-faced Benedict Morelli, this unscrupulous piece of garbage, handled that case. John Quinlan Kelly, the attorney that took on O.J. Simpson and won that civil case, took the case off. We got background on this lawyer, and we got background on the woman that sued him. We went to court. We went to
Bo,
trial.
Bo.
The girl had to pay the
Bo,
guy back.
Shut him off. I mean, if he's not going to let me talk, then he's not going to be on. Go on these other shows, you fat head, and holler at them. Don't call me and then not let me talk. He's banned now from the show forever.
He was finishing his sentence.
No, he wasn't finishing his sentence.
Maybe he didn't hear you.
If there's any tape, it doesn't make any difference. That's not the point. We're going to give Bill the benefit of the doubt, which you should. But for Fox not to report it is jive. I understand. If the NBC Nightly News does 2.5 minutes on it, and every other network news does, and I understand what their agenda is, but I'm not stupid here. But then and Fox is going to be screaming at us forever about we report, you decide, then report this and let us decide. I mean, it doesn't make any difference whether the woman was a willing participant, which I suspect she was. Whether she's trying to jack Bill and Fox up, which I suspect she is. That's all irrelevant. If Bill, who's married with these two kids out here on Long Island, well, we're near Francesca's house, serving as our moral authority, lecturing Ludacris and these other people, and he's making the kinds of phone calls that this woman says he made. If she has any taped evidence that suggests that he said the kinds of things that she says he said, then it's over. Case closed. Doesn't make any. All the other stuff is irrelevant. But she, I'm sure she was trying. I'm not sure, but I mean, I would suspect it sounds to me like they're trying to jack Bill up.
Set him up, no doubt.
No, no question. But he put himself in a position to get set up.
Well, not really. I mean,
go home. What do you mean, not really?
Well, because if you think about it, this is why boys and girls should not work together. I'm being totally serious. We have this animal instinct. You just can't help it. Males and females.
It's primal.
We're like animals. It's primal.
I don't. Charles doesn't. Bernie doesn't.
Well, you used to.
I used to what?
Have it.
Years ago.
When you were potent.
You son of a bitch.
Yeah, you know, I
but now
you.
Since you became impotent.
I'll tell you, if I thought I could get by with it, I would shoot all of you.
He was one of the Time Magazine 25 most impotent men in
a matter of fact. If it weren't for Deirdre and Wyatt, I would shoot you and just do the time. I really hate you guys. I mean, I really hate you. Really.
It was a teenage wedding and the old folks wished him well.
Very.
You could see that Pierre did truly love the mademoiselle. And now the young monsieur and madame have rung the chapel bell.
Hi, this is Brian Dumble for HBO Sports.
At all? May not be technically at all sexual harassment.
Oh, absolutely. But if there's anything to the tapes, as you said.
If there's any tapes,
it's over. There's a price.
Well, people will see him as more human. He'll go on Oprah and cry one day, and everything will be fine. I'll write a book, and everything will be great.
Right.
Just Rush Limbaugh got over it, Bill Clinton.
Oh, my God, you might be right.
That's how I see him.
Martha Stewart's going to write a $5 million book while she's in prison.
Yeah.
We're a forgiving country. We understand people have weaknesses.
Now, he'll be a victim in this. There's no question about it.
We embrace our frailties.
Mm-hmm. Look, you know what? A horny guy should not lose his family, his career, everything else for being a little horny. He didn't even touch this beast. He didn't even touch this animal. He said a couple of things to her. Big deal. She welcomed it, and she decided 2 years later she's had enough. And now she's going to destroy this guy's life. That's nonsense.
Did he exercise poor judgment, perhaps?
Maybe. A little bit.
Very poor with this Sid called an animal.
I think it's going to be.
As you know,
I think it's going to be tough. To try to serve as
the old story, a turgid member has no conscience.
Whatever that means.
I just think it's going to be hard to pontificate to his audience and to try to explain it at home. That's all I'm saying.
Well, he's going to say two wrongs don't make a right. Just because I said that doesn't mean that Eminem should be talking about beating women and killing cops or something. That's what he's going to say. And he's right.
It'll be a rough few months.
It doesn't look good, that's all. It's just...
Ah, come on.
Can he survive this? That's the question.
I think you're probably too. Well, who knows? We don't know what's on the tape. I mean, how freaky does it get?
Good point.
The little brown woman in the Philippines, I can't help you.
Well, and the fact that she claims she can tell he's using a vibrator and stuff like that, but she won't be able to substantiate any of that.
No, she
said
he was
pleasuring himself.
Yeah, he was clearly pleasuring himself as he spoke to her. It is alleged.
Where was he when he was doing this? In his office or where?
Hotel rooms, primarily.
Yeah.
Calling her. Alleged.
It's probably up in the Chappaqua with Bill Clinton.
He was on the expenditure.
Watching the Spank Channel. I've done this before. Don't worry.
Back and he's the Spice Channel on. Can you get that on?
They're going to love you.
Can we conference this, Bill? Are they ugly?
Yeah.
16 out they are.
Gotta get...
arthritis
in one's life happen that are essentially out of your control. I mean, if you make a telephone call with a vibrator in your hand to one of your employees or anybody and have some sort of salacious conversation, it's at some point, if that tape ever surfaces, it can be troubling. But like we were kidding around with David Boies when he represented me in the Judge Rothweiss case, in which the judge sued me for defamation of character, which was
unfortunate. It was unfortunate that during the... while we were trying to reach an agreement settlement on this, and I wanted to be fair, of course, I did lose my temper, but the judge unfortunately died, and that was...
You lost your temper, he lost his life.
Bottom line?
No.
I know he said no. I know he lost it, but there's no connection there.
Well, okay.
But one time, this has been about, I'm trying to think of the date now, it's got to be at least... this is well over 30 years ago. I was living in a suburb of Cleveland, Ohio, and I had a dog named Bingo, who was half German Shepherd, or no, half Great Dane and half Boxer or something. A beautiful dog, and a nice dog.
Sounds like a big dog.
A huge. It was a big dog.
Oof.
And in this development where I lived, why, you know, we had him fenced up. He wasn't a dangerous dog or anything.
Oh, it doesn't sound it.
Yeah.
Well, you're half Dane, half Boxer.
Well, no, he was a great dog.
Oh, sweetheart.
Go ahead. So he got out one day, and he goes, I didn't find out about this incident, by the way, until about 6 months later. But he got out, and he's roaming around the neighborhood, you know, saying hi to everybody, and he goes loping down the back across the lawns of these various homes, and these people had their mother, elderly mother, sitting in a chair out in back getting some sun, I guess. And I was told that Bingo spotted her, ran up and leaped up on her lap and was licking on her face, and unfortunately, well, you know, Senator Kerry hadn't been elected, so she couldn't get out of her chair, and she unfortunately died.
Oh,
my God.
Oh, my God. I thought you were going to say she unfortunately got drooled on. She died?
She had a heart attack. She had a heart attack.
Well,
told jumped on it. She had a heart attack and died.
Hey, John, you're making this up.
Oh, you can't make that up.
Of course you are.
No, but when I, let me just say this, though.
But you're laughing. That's horrible.
You're laughing.
I'm laughing because you're accusing me of... I didn't have anything to do with this.
You're a granny killer.
You're laughing. Look at you. You're crying. He's laughing so he's funny. He's crying.
That's a nice story.
I don't think it's funny at all.
Look,
chain your stupid beast up.
My God.
Let me finish.
But it's not his fault, though. It wasn't his fault.
No.
You should have been. You definitely should have been arrested.
Holy cow.
No, the,
my God. Hey, you step in front of a bus.
Here's my... No. The dog didn't do it. I didn't... The point was, I didn't find out about it until at least 6 months later when the guy who lived next door to me just said, happened to tell me, he said, by the way, did you know, that
your dog killed him?
That's not the way you put it exactly. But he just said, did you know that so-and-so's mom died, and apparently Bingo... But
just because you found out 6 months later doesn't absolve you, doesn't relieve you of any culpability in this woman's death.
Well, then,
just as
this is
10 years later, O.J. still is guilty. It doesn't matter.
This is a horrible story.
Well, apparently the people
and you,
why didn't they complain then?
Well, you know, that's a good question. Maybe who knows?
Maybe they afraid you'd sick it on them too.
Well, no. The dog was a nice dog.
Yeah, it sounds lovely.
That doesn't excuse you whatsoever or absolve you of anything. That's horrible. And you were giving Fred a hard time about not keeping his dog on a leash.
Yeah, his dog bit a poodle or something. Your dog, this sweet grandmother of 80.
Sitting there in her rocker and couldn't get out. And, Jesus.
And she's dead now.
What a story.
That's a great story.
I'm just saying that was the... What's an example of a situation?
That's not your fault.
That I didn't do anything wrong and I was...
How'd the dog get out?
What?
How'd the dog get out, Mr. Responsible Dog Owner?
Bundy in the morning over here.
Well, I mean, I don't know.
I think he chewed his way out of the chain link fence. No, I don't know how. Who knows how he got out?
In all defense of the I-Man, you gotta think the dog's gonna run out and kill somebody. I mean, come on.
Shut up.
He got out because of your negligence.
Exactly.
No, the dog wanted to go say hi to Grandma.
The
The dog didn't want to kill her. He was being friendly.
But the dog shouldn't have had the ability to go say hi to Grandma.
No, but I mean, if the dog had gone down and mauled her, that's different.
Right.
But the dog didn't do that. You know, there was a friendly puppy. Jumps up. Well, not a puppy.
Barely scared the hell out of her.
The dog was the size of a Shetland pony, unfortunately.
It's like when the cops busted into this woman's house in Brooklyn.
And
she died. Grandmother.
She died of a heart attack.
Yeah, they had the wrong apartment. She died of a heart attack.
Sure. Yeah.
Those cops were arrested.
Of course, they forgot to tell
somebody. They were sued.
Right, but they didn't tell the phone. They beat her over the head with a billy club about 50 times.
but they busted the door down. Bingo didn't bust the door down.
Scared the hell out of her.
Still is shock. That's what we're talking. Shock.
Shock and awe.
And you are responsible, as the cops were.
And the worst part of the story is you keep referring to this dog in this, like, lovable term like bingo.
Right.
Like when it's Cujo. It's really what the dog is.
Well.
Bingo.
Maybe I shouldn't have told the story.
No, you shouldn't have brought that up as something that couldn't be.
I just wanted to reveal.
You thought it would be funny, right?
No, I don't know.
I got a good idea for a bit.
No, I don't.
Let me make myself laugh till I cry here for a minute.
No, I'm just laughing at your guy's reaction, which I think is unfair and unwarranted.
You're laughing at Grandma's reaction.
No, well.
Well, Grandma's reaction.
The thing I never understood is why the people didn't say, because they knew that old Bingo was just a happy-go-lucky dog. And why they didn't make a stink about it. So that was what was more troubling to me than anything. I felt bad.
They were in their grief. They didn't think about, well, you know, the avenues they could pursue,
right.
Having you locked up or sued or something like that.
But then I was just trying to remember. It's been 30 years. I can't remember exactly what happened, but.
I mean, the grandmother may have complained about the dog getting out, of course, if she had the opportunity.
She wasn't muzzled.
Well, whatever. Since her reaction was...
to die.
That was unfortunate. All right, Dr. Fred coming up. Happiness is a woman. That's a different fighter.
You don't get it.
She dead or alive? No. What did he do? I guess he came home. I don't know when it happened. I mean, I would imagine when he didn't get a doggy treat or she didn't pet him, probably just thought, well, enough.
You should have spent 10 years in prison getting raped every other night.
Oh, well, why?
Holy cow.
Just the whole attitude.
Well, no, I felt awful about it.
No, you didn't.
Of course I did.
How'd Bingo feel? I mean,
I don't know.
Sense those kinds of things.
But he didn't. My point was he didn't run down and bite the woman. There's a big difference.
There's no arguing with that, Charles.
I don't even know what to say.
Well, he didn't attack the woman. Like these pit bulls and stuff, they attack people. He didn't attack her. He wanted to be friendly, and
she's just as dead.
What?
She's just as dead. Your response, please.
If I pointed a shotgun at you and you died of a heart attack, same thing.
But that's a menacing gesture. He did. The dog didn't make a menacing gesture.
By just being there without a leash.
What's a Great Dane boxer mix with his paws on your shoulders licking your face? What's that? That's a menacing gesture.
That's saying I love you, Grandma.
Oh, my God.
Another clueless dog owner.
Yep, there you
like
go.
Like your brother.
Yep. See, well, that here he is from Tucson, Arizona, sponsored by the Tri-State Jeep dealer, my brother, Fred Imus. Good morning, Fred.
Hey, man, what's happening with the I-Man?
Well, not too bad.
Hey, I don't know if this is going to add anything to your dog story.
Right.
The Bingo was a dog we had when we were kids. The dog in Cleveland's name was Bear.
Bear was a German Shepherd.
I remember Bear.
No, Bear.
That's the dog. When you were living in Parma, in Ohio?
Somewhere in that area, yeah.
Is that dog track time for you? That dog's name was Bear, the one you had in Parma.
No. The Bear was the German Shepherd I had.
Right. Did you have him when you were in Parma?
No. It was a different dog. It's a different dog, Fred.
Maybe you had two dogs. Did one precede the other then while you were still in that area or something?
Well, I can imagine. If this dog was named Bingo, I can imagine what the dog named Bear looked like.
Well, Bingo was a dog we had when we were about 9 years old.
You know something? Bear is a dog. Fred could be right here.
Yeah, I am. And here's the thing about Bear. Let me tell you some more stories about Bear.
Oh, God.
Every time you'd walk by that dog, he'd go, you couldn't walk by that damn dog. And
really?
Then one time up in Connecticut, one of Don's daughter's boyfriends comes up to see Nadine. And And he had, unfortunately, the kid has the window down in his car. And before he stopped the car, that dog was through the window on him.
See, he had a history. Look at him laughing. Yeah.
No, no.
You can't get the dog off, because if you tried to get the dog off, he would attack you.
I think Fred may be right. I think Bear's a dog that I got when I was in Stockton. Some lady called me and I was on the radio there on KJOY.
Yeah.
And I bought that dog then as a puppy.
I remember
that was one mean dog.
You remember Bear? Absolutely.
Because when I would go to your house, you'd say,
no, let me put Bear away.
You'd have to corral Bear before anybody could even get out of the car.
I remember that. I remember Bear, the big, kind of a whitish German Shepherd. Huge dog.
Wow, you should be put to sleep. You really should.
Good Lord. It was when you got out of his house, like dances with wolves. It was unfreaking believable.
Oh, don't worry. It's okay. He's a friendly dog.
Oh, my God. No, he wasn't a friendly dog, but
Bear. No woman. Oh.
Now, this is, I don't know.
No wonder the woman's dead.
I can't remember the details of what
happened. I can remember the details.
You shut up.
What were the details, Freddy?
I got enough stuff on you that you just be quiet.
Bubbling. Yeah, here he is.
So what's going on?
Well, thank God O'Reilly got in this mess.
Why?
I didn't know you couldn't do that. For God's sakes, I mean, well, he is looking out for us. You know that? The guy is looking out for us.
He is on our side.
Yeah.
Who's looking out for you, baby? Bill O'Reilly.
Looking out for you. Doing his Jimmy Swaggart, you know?
What was the worst thing you said to Nicole so far since you started working?
Oh, man, say, I'm just kidding now, but seriously.
Or Stoner.
I mean, that kind of behavior has never even crossed my mind.
Yeah, that's...
I mean, seriously, I joke about it, but seriously, I mean, it's just, I don't understand that kind of behavior.
You don't understand waxing your shillelagh on the phone with a woman?
Oh, you know, what?
That was somebody I work with.
Oh, well, you're a prude.
Seems to me,
you haven't lived.
Seems to me the way your situation is, Fred, that you shouldn't be awfully picky at this point.
Well, ain't that
at work at the petting zoo, it shouldn't matter at this point.
Who are you picking this week in your football game, Fred?
Well, if I'd have known then what I know now,
yeah.
I would have picked Nemechek to win last week. Well, because that's what all these politicians are doing, you know. If I knew now what I knew then, if I knew then what I know now, I would have voted against the war, so I'm going to do my picks that way now. So I'll be picking the NASCAR on Monday until the race is over, because that's the easy way to do it.
Well, no, you got to pick now, and then just say on Monday that if you'd have known then what you know now, you would have picked, say, Gordon and not Junior, you know?
I'm picking Tony Stewart to win this race down in Lowell, North Carolina.
All right.
He won it last year, didn't he?
Well, he might have. You know, he races pretty good down there. Jimmy Johnson don't do bad down there.
Yep.
Is it a short track or?
It's a mile and a half.
Well, they can get going pretty fast.
Yes, but you don't know what can they get going fast. You better believe it.
Mark Martin, I guess, is hanging it up, huh, Fred?
Yes, no, yeah. I don't know what he's doing.
Well, he's not retiring, but he's only going to race a couple of times, right?
Pardon me?
Well, he's not going to retire, but he's only going to race a couple of times.
Well, right? So is Terry Labonte. Terry Labonte is going to run a reduced schedule next year.
I think the clue was when they started driving like they were living in Florida, going 10 miles an hour with their blinker on, that somebody in the pit crew said, you know, maybe we need to get a driver.
You need to cut back your schedule.
Yeah. We need to get a driver who doesn't think he's driving to Denny's for the Blue Plate Special. You understand? So I was like, God bless him, when poor old Dale Earnhardt Sr. fell asleep at the wheel. Remember that?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Well,
anyway, and what? Give me your football picks.
Football picks? I'm picking one college game, my man.
All right.
USC's favored by 10 over Arizona State.
I know which way you're going to go before you even say it. You're going to take the underdog here, aren't you?
I'll take Arizona State because they're the team. They're one team that could beat USC.
I thought Cal was the one team last week that could beat USC.
They did beat them. They just lost in the points. Cal gave up 10 points on muffed kicks, you know. Otherwise, they'd have won that game. California is the better team. And USC has been in trouble in every game they've been in, and you can only do that so often until a good team comes in and beats you.
Right.
And Arizona State's a good enough team to do that.
Where is the game?
It's in the Coliseum in L.A.
USC's the home team. They're not losing this game.
They're not going to lose this game.
No, but we'll find out.
Okay.
Yeah. Your pro games?
A pro game is the Buffalo's favorite 6 over Miami.
Mm-hmm.
I'll take Buffalo, give up the points.
Okay.
Jets 10 over San Francisco.
Right.
I'll I'll take the Jets, give up the 10 points.
Wow.
New England 4 over Seattle. Man, that's a tough game, you know that?
Well, the San Francisco 49ers football team couldn't beat a team comprised of the citizens of San Francisco, if you understand where that man's coming from.
I'm hearing you.
Yeah, what else?
I'll take New England, give up the 4 points.
I think he's 3-0.
Chicago and Washington. Here's a tough game. Chicago and Washington, it's a pick'em game.
Who are you going to take?
I'm going to take Chicago.
Like it. Very good.
Like that?
Yeah, Redskins stink. Joe Gibbs should be fired. He's way past his prime. And you know what? Lovie Smith has those Bears playing tough. They don't win, but they're in every single game. They're going to win this week.
What's Joe Gibbs doing wrong?
Joe Gibbs?
Yeah.
They've lost 4 straight games.
Well, no, he doesn't have the horses.
He doesn't know how to call a timeout. His clock management is horrible. He's an old fart. He's finished. It's over. Seriously, it's over for Joe Gibbs.
I'm picking Pittsburgh over Dallas. Dallas is favored by 3.
I like the Steelers here, too.
Where's that game?
Roethlisberger is a football reincarnation of Terry Bradshaw, except he can read and write.
Something other than X's and O's, right, Freddie?
All right, thanks, Fred. From 15 till the hour here on the Imus Morning Program. Fred Imus with material this morning. And sit here, Sid with sports. Last night the Cardinals won. So that's over, right?
That's over. They're up 2-0. Now, I mean, the Astros do have their best pitchers coming up now. Roy Oswalt and Roger Clemens are going to pitch the next 2 games for Houston. But
bring it on.
Too tough to come back from this. Cardinals are well on their way to the World Series. And the Yankees are up 2-0 as well. Weather permitting, they'll play game 3 in Boston tonight.
Who can beat the Cardinals, either the Yankees or Boston?
Boy, the Cardinals have a tremendous lineup. They really do.
No.
But I think, tough call. If the Yankees get by Boston, I'd have to pick the Yankees to win the World Series.
Uh-huh.
Although the Yankees have lost the last 2 times to the National League champion.
Good.
Losing to the Marlins and the Diamondbacks.
I don't see them beating the Cardinals.
You don't see it? So you think the Cardinals will be the world champions. What happens if the Cardinals win the World Championship, Chuck? What happens? You go home, you revel in the party? Do you go to the ticket tape parade?
You don't go lynch some people?
Yeah.
You go kill some Jews?
What do you?
Knock over some Jewish tombstones?
No. You just wait for next to see if we can repeat.
That's so.
Come on.
Big bonfire out in the backyard.
Don't dismiss it like that. You and your wife and your kid flew out for the games. That's something more than a casual interest in the game.
Okay.
I mean, this phony Senator Kerry like performance from you, pretending that you don't care about it, is absurd.
There could be some weeping.
You'll cry, that's it?
There could be some weeping,
but
tears of joy.
But what would you do for fun, I'm saying?
Big party in the Ozarks?
Right.
Go down there to Bolshoi's Lake and eat a gravy sandwich?
Gravy sandwich gets Budweiser.
Roar up and down that lake a few times.
And,
fire off a Roman candle.
We're not sure that the Yankees and Red Sox are going to play tonight, right?
Weather permitting, they'll play. If not, they'll probably play game 5 Monday. They'll push it forward Saturday, Sunday, Monday.
Well, Wyatt and I are going with Deirdre Imus. She's being honored by the Waterbury Girls Club.
Idiot.
Where she was a member when she was just a little child.
6 years old.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And,
bring back some old memories.
Back in the 90s.
Yeah. And she's going to speak, and she rehearsed her speech last night with me. She's good.
Very well.
Charles helped her with it. And she's, I like her. Well, of course I like her. But she's a lot of fun, and she's a good egg. And
sure.
And at least they're honoring somebody who actually is doing what they say they're doing, as opposed to, you know.
Is this a speech like it was at the Cox Classic, like the Greening thing, or is this something totally different?
A little different.
So that means actually going to be in the Waterbury Girls Club tonight.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, no, it's some hotel up there. I don't know where it is.
No. Is that like Michael Jackson?
One of the problems.
Going into the woods with some Boy Scouts?
Not only do I not know where it is, but Brandt has to go get there.
That's a problem.
So.
Yeah, you know, Brandt is getting worse, isn't he, in his old age, right?
Yes.
Yeah, he's almost done, too.
Directions to find the car.
But he's been driving for 25 years. He's never been.
I know,
it used to be worse when he was on drugs, you know.
Yeah.
Oh, it's a bus stop.
So.
Oh, that's comforting.
Yeah, the limo driver.
Wait a minute.
Well, Brandt, you know, it seems like he was an actor, so this was just something to do to make money in the meantime, and then...
They're acting like he can drive.
Well, I did some of my best cab driving on mescaline.
Right here, a half hour ago.
Like a 10-hour speed trip.
We've had some... One time, we were in Boston. I believe it was Boston, or maybe New Haven, or someplace. No, I think we were in Hartford. Yeah, we were in Hartford, in the limo.
What was the finger made?
And Brant had a kidney stone, and he couldn't drive. So I had to drive the limo from Hartford, Connecticut, back to New York. And have you ever driven a limo?
No.
Well, you know, they're a big, heavy...
Not yet.
No, they're a big, heavy car, and so... You know, I'm taking those curves there on the Merritt Parkway, and you got to be... I was just damn near put it in a ditch, you know, because you got to try to stop quicker than you... Or before you would stop an ordinary car, and it was...
God, shut up.
It's not an easy job for Brant, what I'm saying.
No,
shut up.
We almost lucked out. We almost had a Princess Die episode.
No, that's really
so close.
This lunch break is gonna take all afternoon, half the night. Tomorrow morning, I know there'll be hell to pay. Hey, but that's all right. Jamaican vacation's gonna start right here. At a moment like this, I can't help but wonder, what would Jimmy Buffett do?
Funny you should ask, Alan.
I'd say, oh, it's something tall and strong. Make it a hurricane before I go insane. It's only half past 12, but I don't care.
Do tonight is take my Mercedes S600 because there's a that I got in Friendly Motor Cars in Wappinger Falls, New York. Because there's a thing where you just program in the address where you're going, and then this voice out of somewhere gives you directions as you're driving along. Make a wrong turn, it tells you to turn around, all that sort of thing. Well, that's for an operator. Friendly Motor Cars and Mercedes-Benz of Danbury, two of the premier Mercedes-Benz dealerships in the country. They have, I'll tell you why they are. They have 12,000 active clients between both locations. They offer loyal service. People all been there, most of them. Some of them over 15 years with Ostro. And, of course, Bob Camastro, he's over there co-owning the Mercedes-Benz of Danbury dealership. And Dib and I actually went over there. That's a great dealership. They have a little playroom there for Camastro so he doesn't come out to screw up the deals by making some outrageous demand of these clients and so on. So, but you can hear him squealing in the playroom there in his little jungle gym and stuff. But they're a great dealership. Foster's a great guy. And they're not going to hose you on the deal, and they'll take care of any problems you have. So that's why all these customers keep going back. Friendly Motor Cars, 134 Old Post Road in Wappinger Falls. Mercedes-Benz of Danbury at 100 Federal Road in Danbury, Connecticut. Visit either one of them.
Hi, this is Cindy for the Airport Bar Association. Did your meeting end early? Why not hang around waiting for your flight in a loud, understand?
The U.S., by the way, is being...
One college game, I'm in. USC favored by 10 over Arizona State.
I know which way you're going to go before you even say it. You're going to take the underdog here, aren't you?
I'll take Arizona State because they're the team, they're one team that could beat USC.
I thought Cal was the one team last week that could beat USC.
They did beat them. They just lost in the points. Cal gave up 10 points on muffed kicks, you know. Otherwise, they'd have won that game. California is the better team. And USC has been in trouble in every game they've been in, and you can only do that so often until a good team comes in and beats you.
Right.
And Arizona State's a good enough team to do that.
Where is the game?
It's in the Coliseum in L.A.
USC's the home team. They're not losing this game.
They're not going to lose this game.
No, but we'll find out.
Okay.
Well, enough of that. USC won 45-7.
So what are you telling me that I picked Arizona State? I couldn't have been more emphatic about picking USC.
I had forgotten. I was just hoping that.
Will you apologize to me now?
No, I'm not going to apologize to you.
Will you apologize before this gets a little ugly on television in front of your national audience?
Well, bring it on.
Let's go.
Let it get ugly. Yankees lost last night on the bottom of the 12th.
Yes, they did.
David Ortiz.
Yep. What a chance to win it in the ninth, which was 12:17 a.m. before I went to bed.
You know,
it dropped out.
A guy from the Cardinals. What's his name? Pujols.
Yeah.
Holy God.
Pujols, yeah.
Has he ever not hit the ball out of the park? Well, yeah, he did last night.
Right.
Almost hit it out.
It darn near did.
probably the third best player in baseball, my man, behind Barry Bonds and Alex Rodriguez. Overall.
Does Pujols take steroids like Bonds does?
You know, yeah, probably.
I don't.
Probably.
Does he, Charles?
I have no idea.
Yeah. Just say yes. Just show some guts. It's so easy. I have no idea. I have no idea.
Has anybody
what do
seen
you think? How can you look like that? Hit home runs like that.
Has anybody seen? Has anybody seen Mark McGwire lately?
No.
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 Not anywhere near the size he was.
No.
Haven't seen him in a while.
He's a shriveled up old prune playing shuffleboard somewhere in Delray Beach.
He stays out of the limelight.
Yeah.
I heard somebody say he shows up at an occasional golf tournament.
Yeah.
And now he looks about the size of Pat O'Brien.
Yeah. Lots of these guys.
Weighs about what I weigh.
Lots of these guys stay in the limelight.
Sure.
Except Ken Caminiti. I mean, the guy died last week. He was out of the limelight, too. He was shacked up in some Bronx apartment, you know,
that
doing blow.
So, yeah. So the Boston Red Sox and the Yankees, and I, all they have to do is just keep winning one at a time. They won last night.
Right.
They have Pedro going today.
Yes, they do. Yep.
He pitched a great game. He lost last time, but he pitched a great game.
Pitched well, yes.
They could easily win today.
They could win today. Don't forget, Mike Mussina's been very good for the Yankees as well. So what are you saying?
And then they could come back here and they could win game six.
Yeah, all that could happen.
Right. And then he got a game seven, and it's anybody's game.
Listen, all that could happen.
Yeah.
And you could be in your office about 4:30 this afternoon naked with Angelina Jolie as well.
Right.
But I'm going to bet against it. Not because of you, of course.
Right.
You're looking good. Angelina Jolie, by the way, Esquire magazine's sexiest woman of 2004. Halle Berry came in second,
stupid.
And Britney Spears came in third. And they took a poll on who's got the best butt.
Britney Spears is like a fat, dumpy little pig.
You know,
she?
Now she is, yeah, yeah. Best butt went to Jennifer Lopez, and best boobies went to Jessica Simpson.
That's great, sir.
Thank you.
Well, thank you for sharing that with us. I'm just really happy to hear that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Best mustache for a woman went to Andrea Macklis.
Hey, who would that be?
That's Bill O'Reilly's girl.
Hey, by the way, here's the thing with Bill O'Reilly. Let's just say, just for sake of discussion, that none of this stuff is true, or...
Nonsense.
Well, wait a minute. Or that whatever O'Reilly said was, when you hear it, doesn't sound as salacious as it reads in this complaint. And what if he was just, well, I don't know. I mean, I'm not trying to make excuses for him. Believe me, I'm not that fond of him, since he's turned out to be a phony with me anyway.
Yeah.
But I'm just saying, it does seem just a slightly unfair to me that we've made all these allegations and, well, there's no evidence. I haven't seen any evidence, have you?
No. I'm just trying to figure out how stories about a penis and a brown woman in the Philippines could be misconstrued.
Perhaps they were just
nice
discussing
story.
Vacations, and he might have been saying, yes, I had
could have been like
that
Expedia deal.
Yeah.
Well, no, I mean, I know it sounds ridiculous, but I am saying.
I'm just trying to...
There's always two sides to these stories.
Sure, sure.
Before everybody gets hysterical here.
Huh? He's finished. You understand?
He's
done. Oh, it's all over.
Really?
Not
until we hear a tape.
Yeah, I don't think so. I think you're wrong.
You know, and he's got better taste than to go after this girl who looks like Jimmy Kimmel in a wig. I'm begging you.
And now she's saying in the Daily News, Andrea, that she said, I want my life back.
Well, you know what? Now that you said that, let's not forget, the girl that accused Kobe Bryant of rape, after a while, was very upset, and she said the same exact thing. I want my life back. I'm sick and tired of this thing. And eventually, that case went away, the criminal case at least.
Mm-hmm.
So, the I-Man may be onto something here.
Well, if there are any tapes, I think the goal for Mr. O'Reilly is to somehow
secure...
make a deal to get his hands on the tapes so that maybe he can play them for Mrs. O'Reilly, but that would be about it, not for us. But it does seem, just on the surface... Well, we've seen this happen before. People make these allegations, and then it turns out that that's not quite what the story was. So I guess we need to...
He's guilty, I mean.
For example, we don't really ever know whether Marv Albert was in a hotel room dressed up in a garter belt singing show tunes, do we?
Yeah, we do know that.
How do we know that?
Weren't there pictures or something? Or?
No,
we don't know for a fact. By the way, the girl went to work for CNN for a while. All of a sudden, she shows up back at Fox. Something was going on. There was some sort of setup... going down.
Well, that's highly possible, too. You mean the liberal elite
a bigger conspiracy
after...
than what we might be aware of.
Hmm. Well, I agree.
That's why if there's any tape, why, either put up or shut up. That's what I would say to her. Let me hear the tape.
It's real simple.
It's very simple.
Yeah.
Either you have some evidence or you don't. If you don't have any evidence, shut up.
Because I know my boy Bill can't be into this bestiality.
I just can't imagine that he is. About a local story we had here in New York. A guy stabbed two people, attempting to kill them. His ex-wife, his estranged wife, and her boyfriend, right?
His exactly.
Right.
They were getting a divorce.
Right. And then he stabbed himself to death.
Yes, he did.
Pay attention here, boys and girls. What's the point in stabbing your ex-wife and her boyfriend if you're not going to hang around to enjoy the fact that they're either dead or in the hospital struggling for their life? What's the point? Well, what makes this story even worse is that they're going to pull through.
Yeah.
And stupid is dead.
Yes, he is.
Worse for him, you mean?
Yes.
Well, worse for everybody.
So.
Yep.
And another thing on a different subject. In order to be involved in some organized religion, do you have to wear a stupid hat? Is that
not everyone? Not the
like you guys with your beanies.
And you have beanies too. What does the Pope wear? He wears a big
I'm not a Catholic.
Helicopter hat. Whatever you are.
But he's part of the clergy. I mean, we're talking about the lay people. We don't walk around with silly looking.
You put your fireplace on your forehead every once in a while.
Yeah.
Well, we were talking about hats, were we not?
The headgear, I mean, you know.
Buddhists don't wear any of that stuff, I don't think. I don't think so, right?
I don't know.
Yeah, they wear some fakakta stupid lid. Who knows?
I don't think they do.
All right.
What, are they walking with a poo-poo platter on their head?
At 5 o'clock this afternoon, Pedro Martinez, I guess, and somebody else, Mike Messina for the Yankees, will play again because the Yankees did not wrap it up last night.
No.
And I don't think it's out of the realm of possibility that if you're going to reverse the curse... And I heard the manager of the Reds, well, let's talk to Lubica about it, the nationally syndicated sports columnist, the author of the New York Times bestseller, Travel Team, which of all the books that I've been promoting here lately, there's only two or three of them that are any good. Travel Team's one, On the Wing by Alan Tennant is another, and David Boies' book, Courting Justice, and, of course, George Carlin's books are George Carlin's books. I mean, you would buy those anyway. And
it's an automatic.
And I kind of like Kinky's collection of stuff, so there's a few books around. But if you have to narrow it down to three, I gave you those. Anyway, please welcome Mike Lubica. Good morning, Lippy.
Good morning, Mr. Imus. By the way, I heard you tell you about Mark McGuire before. He has changed a little bit since he stopped playing. He's an exercise writer now for Smarty Jones. I don't know if you knew that or not.
No, I didn't know that. So, is it unrealistic? Is it within the realm of possibility that the Red Sox could win to get this to a seventh game?
No, it's not out of the realm of possibility. I have a feeling they're going to win today. I think Pedro has a chance to get a little bit of redemption, and he's not pitching at Yankee Stadium, so he doesn't have to listen to a three-hour funeral dirge of Who's Your Daddy?
Right.
The funniest poster the other night was a picture of Darth Vader, and it said, Pedro, I am your father. But no, that was an amazing game last night. Rivera, you know, in 8 years as the closer in the postseason, he's blown four saves, and now he's blown two in these playoffs, and I don't think anybody thought that he wasn't going to close the deal and close these guys out. And, you know, it occurred to me watching this game last night, this is the series that we thought it was going to be. You know, we didn't think it was going to be 19-8, and it was going to be, like, incoming all night long the way it was Saturday night. And they finally played the game that we thought was going to be every night of this series. And Mussina has pitched very well for the Yankees, but I think Pedro might have a little something going for him today. And in that case, in an improbable way, they would bring the series back to New York and be right where they were last year, which is the Red Sox coming back to the stadium down 3-2.
Right. And then, so...
Now Schilling is supposed to pitch Game 6. He probably shouldn't have pitched Game 1, but we've discussed that before.
Yeah.
You're going to talk about shutting everybody up. You better be able to back it up, and he didn't. But now they've outfitted him with a brand-new Reebok. High top.
Sure.
That is supposed to enable him to push off better.
Yeah, but it's not going to work, is it?
I don't really think so. No. I don't think his ankle is going to get better anytime soon.
So he needs a moon boot.
He does. He should go out there with a moon boot tomorrow night.
I don't know. No team's ever done it in the history of baseball, right?
No. There was a time a few years ago when the Mets lost the first three to the Braves, won the next two, and played a big extra inning game. And, you know, you always hear the exact same thing from people when they're in this sort of situation, which is somebody's going to do it eventually.
Yeah.
And if they win this game tonight, it gets more fun. I don't think, I mean, maybe Yankee fans wanted these guys out of there and swept, but I think it's going to be a better series now just because of last night, which was one of the great games I ever saw.
Where are you now?
Well, I'm in New Canaan on my way back to Boston.
Well, you sound like you might be with Bill O'Reilly in a motel room. Where are you?
I'm in New Canaan. My boys were at the game last night, but they
right.
had to go to school, so I drove them back after the game, sent them off bleary-eyed to school, and now I have to turn around and go back to Boston.
What time did the game end?
The game ended about 1:30 in the morning.
What time did they get home?
We got home about 4:30.
Big gods. Well, did they get any sleep?
Yeah, they did. They slept in the car, and I was driving, lucky enough to catch a few hours myself.
Well, that sounds insane.
Well, I had made the deal with them.
Well, why wouldn't you let them stay home from school today?
Well,
where do they go to school, in New Canaan?
Yes, I do.
Well, they're not going to learn anything there. All they're going to learn how to buy drugs from other kids.
No.
The school system in New Canaan is horrible.
No. The school system in New Canaan is great.
Well, okay.
So,
they're all in rehab. Why to get back to
No. Please don't say that.
So then you're driving back to Boston?
Well, I'm trying to decide, and I was just wondering, if you think this is wrong, just tell me. What are you doing the iJet this afternoon?
12 minutes after the hour here in the Amsterdam program.
Users are telling
only three, and he.
It's 1:00, by the way.
game prediction, by the way, today. Yankees, Red Sox.
Red Sox win. Pedro okay. gets the win.
Okay, Bernie, what do you think?
He doesn't know.
Red Sox all the way.
Oh, he's right. Okay.
Hello?
Yankees.
Oh, Chuck?
Yankees.
Close it out. 2-2. You know what that means? I miss in the morning. Your name's on the showcase. 2-2 tie. You make the call right here.
Break it.
Red Sox.
Yes. That's why you are a legend. That's why. Right there.
Well, what if I'm wrong? I'd be just a schmuck, right?
No. You'll
sure. That would be the case anyway.
Right.
Oh, really?
Reverse the curse.
Whoa, come on. Maybe if I felt better, I'd come out there.
Yeah.
Hey, Chuck, what's going on in the world, baby?
New poll, I'm in.
All right.
This is Zogby.
Yeah.
Just released.
Unreliable. Follow.
John Kerry has pulled into a statistical dead heat with the president in the race for the White House.
Maybe not so unreliable.
Daily tracking poll, 45-45.
Oh, my God.
CNN, USA Today Gallup, the new Gallup poll. After three debates that drew tens of millions of viewers, the president leads Kerry, according to Gallup, 52-44, 8 points.
Yeah.
That's a significant shift, it is pointed out here, from Kerry's 1 percentage point advantage a week earlier. Encouraging movement for Bush, but hardly a safe margin.
Doesn't sound right to that, man.
With 15 days to go.
Huh?
So, those are the very latest polls. Couple.
2 weeks from tomorrow we vote.
Yep. Precisely.
Well.
The rhetoric is heating up. John Kerry alleging that President Bush is planning to reform Social Security. Kerry telling supporters in both Ohio and Florida over the weekend that Bush, if elected, will act to reduce Social Security benefits by 45%, about $500 a month for many Americans. The president says, this is the thing that came out of the New York Times Sunday magazine,
right,
that it had misquoted him and saying that is simply not the case.
Sure.
Newspapers across the nation giving their opinion on who they think would be the better person in the White House. New York Times.
Well, let me guess. New York Times, they endorsed. Let me see.
Think. You got to really think this one through.
Let me see. Nader?
No.
Okay. I don't know.
Fidel Castro.
Senator John Kerry.
Vladimir Putin.
The paper went on to describe the Bush presidency as a disaster.
Really?
President Bush won the endorsement of the Chicago Tribune.
Okay.
Editor and Publisher, a journal that tracks the newspaper industry, says Kerry has picked up 42 newspaper endorsements to Mr. Bush's 22.
We aren't.
Kerry will be on the stump in the election battleground state of Florida today, as polls actually open across Florida today, at least for early voting. Early voting begins in Florida today.
You know, if Bob Kerry were running, that would be an offensive phrase.
On the thump?
Yeah.
It would be. We would probably use something different.
Right.
On the campaign trail, whatever.
Uh-huh.
Considering the turmoil that followed the 2000 vote, Florida Governor Jeb Bush expressed...
What's the
matter? That ain't right.
Well,
I mean...
Well, still, it would be something you'd have to consider.
It left his limb in the jungles of South Vietnam.
I understand that.
So what? So do Linda McCartney. Look what you say about her. You're always... What does he call Linda McCartney?
Wait.
I didn't call Linda McCartney.
What does he call Linda McCartney?
The gold digging stump?
Stumpy the gold digger.
Stumpy the gold digger.
She's not a war hero giving a, you know, risking a life for a country.
Ah, same thing. Lose a leg. Cut it out.
It's not Linda either.
A little respect for our war heroes.
Linda's gone.
Right.
Linda died.
Yeah.
Whatever.
Not Linda.
No.
Whatever.
Not whatever. What do you mean, whatever?
Whatever. Whoever's married to Paul McCartney.
Yeah. God forbid something happened to Carol. Is that what you would say? Whatever?
Linda McCartney.
Let's leave my wife out of this.
Yeah, take it easy. Don't get nuts.
Hey, by the way, the bottom line on Kerry with... let me point this out to you, Bernard. About mentioning the Cheney's daughter. The parents have a right to use their kids in any fashion they want. You do not have a right to use to talk about somebody else's kids in any context. Period.
If they bring it up,
then that's different. But in the course of conversation, if the president had brought up Dick Cheney's daughter or had alluded to it somehow, then that's different. But I think Senator Kerry realizes that it was just gratuitous, and we know why he did it. But there's just an unwritten rule, and you can say whatever you want about your kid, but don't let somebody else say it. It's like the way I feel about certain friends of mine, like Bill Maher, for example. Or Charles and I feel about Bill Maher. I mean, we like Bill Maher. When somebody says something bad about him, we defend him and we get angry. Or about you guys.
We don't like Bill Maher, Bernie and I.
I like Bill Maher, but you know what the real bottom line is?
No.
American families are ashamed to have a homosexual in their family. That's the bottom line.
Sure.
Are you speaking from personal experience?
I'm speaking from this particular episode that we just went through. People are ashamed. If Cheney had a son who was in Iraq and Kerry brought that up, nobody'd be upset about it. But it's akin to having a heroin addict as a son.
Oh, you're wrong.
It's a handicap, and that's why Americans feel that way.
She worked in his campaign. There hasn't ever been any demonstration that they're ashamed of her, nor should they be. But Senator Kerry was wrong. You need to own up to it. Charles continues.
The woman who is accusing Fox News host Bill O'Reilly of sexual harassment says her life has been upended by the entire incident.
Right.
Andrea Macris also tells the New York Daily News she is determined to stay in journalism despite the unfolding scandal. The Daily News is also reporting that O'Reilly has hired private security to sit in front of his home on Long Island, New York. Daily News said O'Reilly's wife, Maureen, kept quiet yesterday as she pulled out of the family's driveway. She commented, though, quote, "This is a private road."
It's over. That's over. Just like McGreevy and his wife were looking for two different pads this weekend in New Jersey. Far away from each other, by the way. That's over.
Well, Dick Morris and his wife stayed together, so yeah. You don't know what's over.
They overcame that.
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, we don't know.
I don't know what Dick Morris is. That's the only problem. I don't really know what you're talking about.
It's not my job to try to defend Bill O'Reilly.
Bill and Hillary, how about that?
No, but I...
There you go.
But
good
point. I think you got a... What?
Who's that?
Bill and Hillary. They're staying together.
Wow, well,
but I think you're... It just troubles me when somebody makes these kinds of allegations and they get this wide sort of play, and then we don't have any evidence.
Yep.
And, I mean, if there were tapes, and they won't say whether they're tapes or not, it's a little too cute by half, you know, and then Bernard had a good point, and why did she leave Fox, go to CNN, and then all of a sudden decide to go back to Fox?
Mm-hmm. Something very suspicious.
I mean, I'm not defending anybody. Believe me, I'm not. But there's always two sides to these stories.
Evidence, maybe.
And it doesn't make anybody right or wrong, but I'd be a lot more comfortable if there were some evidence involved here.
A stained garment of some kind, something.
One would hope.
Or the Linda Tripp tapes, remember?
Some
that?
Tapes, sure. Either some tapes... Or some Lovick on a garment, something.
Yeah,
they have it. You know, guys, this thing just came out a couple of days ago. It's not going to come to you in 3 days. They're putting the thing together. They've got it. They've got it. They've got phone messages on a voicemail. They've got
they
all this
better.
Stuff.
They better. They better because you can't ruin somebody's life like this.
Precisely.
Unless you have some evidence. That's all I'm saying. I mean, whatever.
But then what are you going to say? If it is true, if it's all true, then what?
There's a scheme, a setup scheme.
Well, we haven't seen any.
I haven't seen any evidence. I don't know what I'd say. What difference does it make what I'd say?
I don't know. I
would say, well, there's evidence.
I have said from day one, the only problem I think he has is that he looks like a hypocrite and he has to explain it to his wife.
Yeah.
And ultimately to himself.
Well, here's a question I have for his wife. Not for the workplace, because this sexual harassment thing I think is stupid, I think, personally.
Sure.
If you don't touch the girl, you can say whatever the hell you want. But if...
What?
If you're at work...
What did you just say?
If you don't touch the girl walks by you, and you go, oh, honey, you look great today. Wow, you got a great ass. What is the big deal? Who cares? You're going to sue
somebody
for that?
You're going to get fired here if you do that.
Who?
You are going to get fired.
You'd be out. You'd be gone.
You sure?
Yes.
All
right. I mean, just because Tracy doesn't complain. But try that with Courtney or Julie, and you're gone.
I'm saying is I think it's too. They take it too far. But if you think your wife would think that's cheating, if you never touched the girl, never, all you did was say, wow, that girl looks hot.
Oh, you're a pig.
What, your wife would say that's cheating?
You're a pig.
Why? Cheating on your wife? If you say, wow, you look pretty today,
I didn't say that. Don't ask me any questions. I'm making an observation about you. You're a dirtbag.
And girl.
Huh?
And good is gone.
Yes.
Good
Lord. We got to get rid of two things in this country right now.
We got to get rid of you.
Two things. The act that has everybody get jobs, minorities, what do you call that?
Affirmative action.
That's got to go.
How do you think you got your job?
You idiot. Get rid of that and sexual harassment. If you don't touch the person, whatever you say, let it go in one ear, out the other. And some girls love it. Some girls love it.
Oh, my God almighty. Bernard, are you hearing this?
Well, Bernard agreed to me.
I got to say, makes some sense.
Oh, my God almighty.
Now I'm here to go.